Jessica Henry here. I am at the beach today. This is Robert Moses State Park in New York on Long Island, and it is beautiful today. What I'm going to do here, and I thought that this was going to be kind of fun, I'm going to take, I have an 11 by 14 canvas, and I'm going to take elements of that lighthouse here behind me and the ocean and put them together in one painting. So part of the video is going to be up here painting that, and then I'm going to stop it and then go down to the water and include some of that in the painting. So I'll talk a little bit about how I'm going to compose that and how to just take other elements in a landscape and put them together. I think it should be kind of fun. I'm going to not be talking while I paint so that I will go back over and do a voiceover. All right, thanks guys. All right, so when I get to a location, I always find where I think it'd be the best scene. And I just begin setting up. I can always isolate my scene better with a drawing. And but for now, I just gonna put up my umbrella. I decided I would use it just to help me be in the shade. This is my palette. I use titanium white, cadmium yellow pale, yellow ochre, burnt sienna, ultramarine blue, phthalo green, and alizarin crimson. I have my gamsol and my brushes. And a beautiful scene. What more could you want? All right, so I start out with the sketch, and my little rectangle is the same ratio as my 11 by 14 canvas. And that is just a gesso panel I'm using today, 1/8 inch masonite. So I'm looking at how to best compose this picture. I'm gonna take different elements, like I said. I'm gonna use the lighthouse, and then I'm thinking about how I want to incorporate the ocean into that. So if I have the lighthouse, using it as reference, off to the left of my canvas, and then sort of break up the lower third portion of the canvas with the ocean, it might be interesting. So I put the canvas, I put the lighthouse off to that side, and I'm thinking about how compositionally I can use the darks of the grass and sort of have that frame in the lighthouse as well as the dark of the ocean framing in the lower corner, right-hand corner of the painting. So I'm kind of putting those things together in my head, and I'm thinking about a way that I can tie both elements in together because they're not in the same scene. I'm satisfied with the drawing, so it's time to begin. I start with a soupy mixture of burnt sienna and ultramarine blue and some paint thinner. And then I just draw on what I had for my thumbnail sketch, and I don't worry so much about what I see in nature at this point, because I was in my analytical left brain when I was composing that sketch. So I'm going to use that to begin my painting. Now here I made it to half and half, so I lowered the horizon line a little bit. You can just take your brush and help with that. So that is a little bit of thinner, and I just rubbed it out. Then you can wipe it off and keep going. Very quick eraser method. I never draw on with the pencil. Just a little paint, thin down. You can use basically any color you want. I just choose these colors because it gives me a nice value range. It's just a dark neutral tone. Mm-hmm. So I'm drawing out what I had in my sketch.
Yeah.
And thinking about where those darker values are going to be, I always want to isolate where my anchors are going to go. I didn't feel it was necessary to do the three different value range in the sketch because everything pretty much is in a middle tone. So to me, it was a matter of where are my darks going to go? And then looking out, I knew where my lights were going to go. My lightest lights were going to be, you know, parts of the clouds, the ocean waves. And I would just add those later. The sand has a very bright light too. And so, sketching loosely in where the clouds were gonna go. The clouds were really cooperative. They just kind of held still all day, which was really nice. This entire painting took about 2.5 hours to paint. So I narrowed it down to 30 minutes. Just mixing up a little, I added a little bit more white and blue to that mixture because I was gonna pop in some more of those bluer tones. Now I'm showing you how I mix the sky color. I take a lot of white and a little ultramarine blue, and right at the top of the sky on my canvas I use, it's almost a more violet blue, and then as it goes down towards the horizon, okay, so that's my linseed oil. as it goes down to the horizon, I'll warm it up a little bit. So I use a little tiny bit of linseed oil just to thin out my mixture a little, because it just kind of, it doesn't flow off the brush sometimes as well as I'd like. And skies, it's not necessary to paint with thick, juicy brush strokes, even though sometimes I do. So I kind of try to thin it out just a little. Okay, so I took a little bit of phthalo green and a little more white, and I'm mixing that with the blue mixture. And look how it warms it up just a little bit. And I sped this up so that it didn't take all day. But yeah, you can see how it kind of warms it up, almost a little buttery. I've tried adding yellow to it in the past to warm it up, and it turns green, obviously. So it seems odd. It's like fighting fire with fire. You add green and it warms it up just right. So just, I don't want to blend. I don't use cross-hatching and so forth to get a smooth sky. I just use smaller pieces of paint. And there is the sky and scene. Okay, so again, just as you can see, I'm just working on finishing up the rest of the sky, making sure that it's just warm and quiet down there. All right, getting some of that cloud mixture, mixing up a little bit more alizarin crimson into that same mixture. I wanted it a little violet, and then I added some yellow ochre to warm it up. Looking at that value range for the darks of those clouds. I'm just laying down pieces of paint at this point. Again, making careful brush strokes, trying not to get too blendy, lightening the value where I see it. And a lot of times what you can't see is that I'm squinting down at the clouds over there just to try to get that perspective of the right value range, and it flattens it out so that you can gauge those values and colors better. And sometimes I would adjust the what I was painting to be a little bit more bluer or a little bit more rosy. You can kind of see as I'm working on this here. And what I'm using for brush, this is just a size 4 flat bristle brush. Towards the horizon, I noticed that it everything just kind of got more muted over there. And I didn't want a lot of contrast on the edge of the canvas to draw the eye off the edge. Which I think, I mean, you can kind of even see behind the canvas back there, the sky. It's just a kind of a muted gray. So I was trying to capture that. And then there were some streaky clouds above that mass of storm clouds, so I just tried to get some of those in there too. And that, again, like I said, is just a mixture of the ultramarine blue, white, a little bit of alizarin crimson, and some yellow ochre to warm it up a little. And so right there, right before the ocean meets the sky, there's this haze of salty air that is just atmospheric, and you can kind of see it. So I wanted to try to capture some of that. All right, now again, as I'm working on these clouds, and I've squinted and I'm looking at the background there, I'm just looking for transitions where I see, as the clouds turn and go up towards the sky, they lighten in value. And that is just what I'm working on there. I could have probably spent all day on these clouds. They were just so beautiful, and they were pretty much holding still. So that was a lot of fun, and I enjoyed that. So just trying to hold this brush, and this is a smaller size 2 flat, and it is a synthetic, so it's softer. And so I'm just laying down little pieces of paint, trying to think of the sculpture of the cloud as it's turning, and using the different values. As I noticed when I looked out at this stretch of clouds, that a lot of them had sort of this rosy glow. So I was trying to capture some of that with a little bit of alizarin crimson, yellow ochre, cadmium yellow pale, and then a white, just to sort of create that peach tone. And so that's what I'm putting on here, a little bit of that. I'm still just leaving the white of the canvas for those parts that where I'll put the brighter tone on. So I zoomed in a little bit more here so you could see up close. Some of those peach tones I made a little bit more rosier, and some more orangey tone, just to add some variety. Okay, so again here, as it's going off the edge of the canvas, I'm neutralizing the values and the contrast. I didn't want to draw the eye straight off the canvas. So now here I have made a little bit darker blue mixture of the clouds, because under the clouds where they roll and go back was just this beautiful storm cloud blue. So that's sort of what I was working on there. So before I even get to the highlights, I'm getting the two values, the medium and the darker range. So here I'm going to start to work on the highlights, which is just white and cadmium yellow pale, a little bit of yellow. And so using that small size 2 brush, I'm just kind of curling and twisting it as I go along, and then I will soften those edges so that they're not so stark. And you can, I mean, once in a while, you can use your finger or a dry brush or whatever and just sort of flick. So there's another shot of the storm clouds and the lighthouse. I thought that this idea of this painting, I mean, a lot of people paint lighthouses, but it just was so pretty, and I really enjoyed it, especially these clouds as they were around it. You can see here I'm starting to soften some of those edges of the whites. Just working on the darker tones now. Taking ultramarine blue, burnt sienna, a little bit of white, and laying clean pieces of paint. This lighthouse actually took me longer than it shows, longer to paint than it shows here in the video, because it was a lot of straight lines with a slight taper. So I tried not to get really fussy with it, but if it's off a little, it'll show. So I use, instead of bringing a whole big mahl stick with me, I just take another paintbrush, and then I lean it against the edge of the canvas like that, and it helps to steady my hand so I didn't rest it on the wet clouds. So I'm using a horizontal stroke after I laid down the shape of it. And then there's this white bar on this lighthouse, sort of this white middle section that I didn't want to paint white, so I just neutralized it a little bit with some of that darker tone. Putting in the windows and the light in the lighthouse. I think I went back through and made that white a little brighter. And then I took burnt sienna and a little bit of cadmium yellow pale to get this rusty red roof of this building that was right below it. So anytime you're painting buildings, you want to roll your brush on your palette and then turn it one side and the other side to get a nice flat edge so you can get clean, sharp lines. You can always go back through and soften edges where you feel that they need to be softened, but just to get that architectural feel. All right, so got the red, and I just put a little pop of it left off to the left of there because there was a little roof. Oh, I guess there's my light. Every 8 seconds that lighthouse shone. All right, so that was an old stone building, so I mixed a little bit, just my sort of a gray, ultramarine blue, burnt sienna, white, and a little yellow ochre to get that grayish tone. And then they had these tents set up too, and I just thought it had a really festive feel. So I put those in with white and a little bit of yellow. Again, just a clean, sharp, chiseled edge on my brush. So just trying to keep my brushwork clean and simple. And I didn't want things to be very distracting, so I let a little bit of that background color mix with those tints so that they weren't stark white. And just refining the shape and getting the legs. So again here, chiseled edge on my brush, just to show the paint trim on the building there. And clean that up. Little bits like that, as you add them to architecture, really help you don't need a whole lot of information, just a little bit to suggest what's going on there. So under these tent roofs is some more of that gray mixture that I had for the stone of the building. And that's what I'm working on there. Just keeping it clean. And then I will hide those legs a little bit more with the darker mixture, and that's what I'm mixing up here. Just sort of a darker green. I took that same dark mixture of that I used for the lighthouse and added a little bit of yellow ochre to it. I think a little bit of phthalo green too. So I'm laying those in, just getting the dark tones of the foliage there. I'll add highlights and such as I move down the hill, but I want those in the background to really offset the storm clouds and the lighthouse. And you can just flick your brush up to show a little bit of pine trees or other texture on the faraway hill there. So this is really mostly just helping to frame in and set back all of that architecture back there. So to me, that dark was an important compositional element. And then just, again, laying down pieces of paint as it comes down the hill. I'm thinking about the shadows underneath the tufts of beech grass. I've added a little bit more ochre and white to the lighter tone there as it moves down. And just little pieces of paint. And I'm using that little smaller brush stroke that just kind of goes just vertical, a little vertical brushwork, because that's kind of, it suggests beech grass as it sort of grows that way. So I'm also looking at, and I'm sorry I didn't get a picture of what I was referring to here with the beech grass. I looked all over my files and I did not have a reference photo of the beech grass hill there. It's a beautiful ocean. That I break it up. This is intermission. All right, so more of that pattern of the beach grass as it goes down the hill. And that, again, it's just more of the yellow ochre, a little bit of white with that green mixture that I had. Just paying special attention to that sort of, it's almost like this lacy pattern of beach grass. And of course, you have to use it to work to your compositional advantage. Thinking all the time about where I'm going to lead the eye in to the canvas and how it can play around in that hillside and the water, and then it'll go back out. So now I've mixed up a sand color using ultramarine blue, a little bit of ultramarine blue, yellow ochre, burnt sienna, and some white. Most of what I use is that color combination, but just in different ratios. So as it moves towards me, it gets a little bit warmer. Further away, it gets a whiter, lighter blue tone to it, the sand. So I just try to keep that in mind while I'm painting it, adding a little bit of texture and land formation as I go along. So this is that distant cliff over there that I thought was really interesting, and I wanted to try to get that feeling of that sandy cliff, erosion and all that. Using your brush strokes to your advantage to show land formation is critical in doing any kind of landscape painting. It's allowing that brushstroke to really define form. So I'm thinking about the flat of the sand here as it comes out, keeping my brushstrokes horizontal down there. And also thinking about that warm, cool vibrancy as it's playing in the sand, and you've got shadows and texture. And so I'm alternating warm, cool. On my palette, I have mixtures of the different kinds of sand colors that I was seeing. And then so back there, I'm just popping in. After I got the sand done, I wanted a few more darker accents just to define that form. Got a little bit mushy. So that is That's just a darker, whatever I had for the lighthouse. Just to pull that down a little. So that's that, cleaning it up. And defining that form of the distant cliff over there. Looking like the scene? And then I was also, you can see I'm adding some beach grass because I felt that lower portion there needed a little bit more texture, but didn't want it distracting. So that is just sort of an olive green tone, giving it a little bit of lead in and interest on the beach.
Passage in here because I want the rest to be down by the water.
All right. It goes up the hill a little bit. And then I just took a little bit of time cleaning some things up that I just had a lot of white of the canvas showing, so I just kind of went through and worked on that. All right. Then I moved down the beach and I'm going to add the water to this part of the painting. And you saw that I had drawn the shape of where I wanted the water going. So at this point in the painting, I am working on the sand as it approaches the water. And there's all these beautiful different color tones happening, and I wanted to pick up some of those rosy tones and the violets in the wet sand. So here I am concentrating on that darker wet sand color that I saw. And I'm going to push some of those violet tones a little bit more than, maybe a little bit more than what they are in reality. So there is my darker mixture of just ultramarine blue, burnt sienna, a little bit of white and yellow over just to help keep it not so blackish. And then I also wanted to be aware of the edges of each of my brush strokes. So if I'd laid a brush stroke down that was too edgy, it just was too contrasty, I wanted to try to keep those a little bit softer. And so I'm looking at it and thinking about how it transitions down into the water. And like with anything, when you paint water, you want to look at the color that's underneath the surface. So all of this wet sand and water I'm going to paint without the highlights. And I will add those to the top later, the ocean splashy waves and the foamy water on the sand. So I'm trying to look at when a wave will come up and that sand, that foamy wave lacy pattern comes over, I'm looking at the color that's underneath that. Because by the time I've added all that white, it's going to lighten that whole passage. So I'm looking for those darker tones. So it might seem that I'm painting it a little darker than what reality is, but that's why, because I'm thinking ahead that I'm going to paint it lighter over the top. So beginning that beautiful ocean sapphire color, this is ultramarine blue, phthalo green, and a little bit of yellow ochre. And as I come down towards me, I add more yellow ochre and white to that phthalo green mixture. I also wanted my horizon line there to be a little bit softer. I kind of go back and I just light softly just where it meets the sky because I didn't want it to be too contrasty. And also where it meets the beach way over there. I wanted that value to be a little bit lighter too. So now I'm working on that really pretty color, phthalo green, cadmium yellow pale, a little bit of white as it comes down towards us. I'm laying down pieces of paint. Water is horizontal, so I try to keep my brush strokes horizontal as well. All the time I'm looking at it too and looking for passages where I see the sky bouncing on the surface of the water and it makes it sort of a baby blue tone on top of the water. Right. I have to say, I think that I liked painting the water most of all. It's so pretty. If I'd brought a second canvas, I probably would have done two paintings of one of just the water and one of the lighthouse, but I was happy to try to put them both together in a painting. I thought it would have make it interesting. And a lot of times when you go somewhere, you might see two different scenes in one place and you start to think, how can I put these two together in a painting? And so just taking elements and then moving your easel, and but definitely having a game plan and a strategy before you begin will help you in the execution of it. So in this case, I came up with that sketch, and you saw it didn't take me very long. It shouldn't, you know, thumbnail sketches, just a couple minutes, get your plan figured out, and then move your easel if you have to. But you want to do it in a way so that your lighting is consistent. Sometimes in the studio, we take a couple different references, but just be cognizant of your lighting. I've seen some paintings where the lighting on one object is different than the lighting on the background or whatever, so it doesn't make sense. Our brain kind of understands that there's something not right there. So, all right, so now, again, like I said, I don't have any light value in this passage yet because I'm going to add that later. So getting the darker passage where the wet sand meets the water. And that is really, that's just a little more alizarin crimson and ultramarine blue to get that violet tone. Looking at some of these ocean waves. Where I see the crest of the wave, where the water picks up and starts to turn, I make it a little bit more cadmium yellow and phthalo green and some white. And so that's just what I'm working on there. Again, looking at that whole sand, wet sand passage that is under that pancake lace wave stuff. And that's what I'm mixing up there. And now I'm taking my smaller brush, size 2, flat, and I'm just going to start to put in my whites. Way over there. Just as I see them, just enough to make that back passage interesting. I don't want it to be very distracting, but it's got to start to feel like water and ocean waves and that beautiful white. So I'm allowing these brush strokes here to define the form and the contour of the waterline. And so I spent some time here just looking at some of the waves. And I didn't want to get really fussy with wave anatomy and all of that because the concept of this painting was I'm using the water to help bring the eye up to the lighthouse and the storm clouds. So as tempting as it was to really just focus on those waves and the water, I had to make it interesting but not distracting. So I'll do another painting down here sometime with the water like this and just do some clean, beautiful little ocean waves. Those are always fun videos too, very relaxing. I've received letters from people that I'm putting you to sleep with these ocean waves and the sound, so these are ASMR videos, right? Happy little waves, just relax. Well, plein air painting is very relaxing and rejuvenating, and so you sleep well on these days that you get out and do this. All right, so I'm thinking about these lacy foam patterns, and it can get overwhelming, and you can add too many brush strokes, and it can quickly get cluttered, so I'm trying really hard to just think about simplifying and simple shapes, and looking at the overall, try to catch one when it comes up, find one that you like, capture that, and so that's what I'm looking at there, that beautiful pancake sort of feel. Without it being overwhelming, just enough to draw the eye in. So you can see how by adding that darker passage underneath that, and now that I've added the foam to it, it reads better. It's more like, hopefully a little bit more believable. So I'm adding the curves of the waves and some of those things, just subtly. Little splashes. finding a few things. And then these are just little brush strokes to show some of those curls in the wave. Something back there. Gotta say, that water was really warm too. It was very inviting. So, just cleaning this up and tightening it up. And that is just more of the cadmium yellow mixture as I saw it there. Alright. And you know, if you guys have any questions about what I'm doing, or if you have any requests of things that you would like to see me paint in the future, go ahead and leave them in the comment section. I do read all the comments and try to get to each one of them. And it's really special. Thank you guys for your input and your encouragement and support. It means a lot. I really appreciate it. I've only been here on YouTube for a little while and I'm just overwhelmed with the support, as well as my Facebookers. I put these videos on Facebook as well. So I really appreciate all of you guys, and I will continue to make these videos as long as I'm able to and try to improve each one as I go along. And they take a lot of work, and I'm really just really glad that they are appreciated and you guys are enjoying them. Each video takes about 2 days to make, and I have a lot of fun. What I'm doing here is I'm adding a little bit darker accent to just where the waves come, and there's that foam underneath, and or the dark accent under the foam. So I'm just popping in some of those places where I can see that gives a little bit more dimension in there. And then I'm pretty much done with this painting, or at least for now. I mean, I may go back to the studio and fiddle with it a little bit, but this has been a really enjoyable one, and thank you so much for joining me on this. And it means a lot. You guys are awesome. I really appreciate it. Enjoy this. All right, well, that's as far as I'm going to take this. I just wanted to wrap this up.